anticipating the future. And every year, every 2 years, you'd see in the big magazines pictures of future. These pictures of future are invariably wrong. You remember the ones where instead of cars, people said little planes going right through towns and all sorts of things. It didn't work out that way. So it's, I think, a dangerous and not very helpful thing to try and imagine it. What I think one can imagine is the problems. There's no doubt at all about it that technology, the human capacity to create extraordinary new products, services, and so on, will continue. It has now reached the point where clearly it is in a position actually to do serious, in some cases, irreparable harm to the globe. Human power is so great. You know, for instance, at this very moment, people are discussing in the European Union whether the fishing of cod should be completely banned in the Atlantic Ocean and in the North Sea and elsewhere. Well, in the past, this would have been inconceivable, because if there was something that was inexhaustible, it was the sea. We can exhaust the sea now. Now, that is a problem which will undoubtedly face us in one way or another, but exactly how it will face us, it is not easy to see. I think what is most hard to imagine, I find, is this. In the course of the last 30, 40 years, as part of this extraordinary acceleration of history, the rules and conventions by which human beings live together have gradually become eroded and in some instances broken down. Such institutions as families, for that matter, states, assumptions about life, which both people have, communities have, and so on. And it is extraordinarily difficult to imagine, for those of us who do not fully live in this new society, what actually it is going to be like. We can see somebody like myself, because I'm old enough to have lived at a time when conventions were strong, when, you know, for instance, the relations between parents and children, between husbands and wives, between neighbors, you know, were ruled by fairly strong and not easily broken customs or prohibitions, which no longer operate. Now, that, I think, will produce an enormous tensions, enormous discontents. Somebody of my age can see the downside of this, the danger of this. It is possible that young people are used to this, you might say, life without any regular compass and orientation by the old orientations may not find it so disturbing. But I am fairly pessimistic about it.
Is the youth pessimistic as well?
I'm not sure that you can generalize about it. I'm not sure that you can generalize about youth, because youth changes very rapidly. There are times when youth develops enormous optimism. For instance, in 1968, in large parts of the Western world, at least certain parts of youth, students, middle-class youth, believed that everything was possible. They discovered it wasn't, but then any generation is likely to discover that everything is not possible. On the other hand, then you may find a generation which has no great hopes, which retires into private life. As a teacher, I have lived through various student generations which varied from my own, which was enormously radical, which means optimistic, if you like, hoping to change the world, to generations which really didn't want anything except a good job with a lot of money. I don't think I would make youth as such responsible for either of these things.
The past is another country. You wrote in your book and added, a historian not only revisits it, but maps it. How do you map your own life?
Yes, it wasn't actually me that invented the phrase, the past is another country, but an English novelist. The past is another country, they do things differently there, yes. Mapping the past is the hard part. Once you have mapped it, mapping the track of a particular life through this country is comparatively easy. I mean, you follow the, as it were, the profile and the outlines. I've tried to map it as a historian because the past is not something that stays the same. It keeps changing, and this is the interest of it for a historian. I've tried to really map it in two connected ways. First of all, I've been trying to see how society changes by virtue of the transformations of basically the economic and social system, capitalism, which has been the great dynamizing element in changing history over the past 200 years or so, and how you can periodize the period, including your own life, accordingly. But since one of the main elements in the impact of capitalism in the world is precisely that it conquers the world, globalization is, if you like, another more specific dimension of this map. And both my life and the 20th century is one in which, you might say, Europe or history can no longer be written in terms of Europe or the European countries or what they did. It has to become global, and in fact, this is a process which isn't finished yet, because it is still becoming global, because, the vast areas of Asia, Southeast Asia, East Asia, which traditionally, for most of history, were, you might say, the center of human civilization up to about the 15th century, are once again becoming increasingly important and increasingly central. But that is something, most of that is something which will happen after my own lifetime. So these two elements, I think, are the way in which I try and explain, you know, the map of the history of the 20th century. Where I fit in is, if you like, I'm lucky enough, my life coincides with a fairly coherent historical period, the one which starts with the First World War and ends sometimes in the 1990s. And so the historic periods are also periods in my life, in my own experience. The age of catastrophe, the world wars, the world slump, all that, is something which I can see, I have experienced in one way or another. The age, what the French call les trente glorieuses, the 30 glorious years, what I've called in my book the golden years, are something which I also experienced. And so the same with the difficult and problematic period which begins in the 1970s. And so in this sense, I structure both my book